So factoring.
Those who don't know need, like, pants of ears perk up. This is the only way we survive. Literally, the only way we survive.
It's getting capital based on your invoice. It allows you to receive upfront capital based on the invoices that you submitted to your retail partner. And you now have upfront capital to do operating, to make your product as much as possible based on those invoices.
If you are not familiar or have no idea about invoice factoring, then you must listen to this invoice factoring series, starting with episode 64, where I had a conversation with Rachel Hurst from Prestige Capital. Prestige Capital is a factoring company. Then I want you to continue listening to episode 71 with Lauren Picasso, the founder and CEO of Cure Hydration, as well as today's episode, episode 72, with Ceata and Garrett Lash from the PuffCuff. Both businesses were introduced to invoice factoring, and they love it. So before you say no, this isn't for my business, have a listen first. You will understand about invoice factoring from the lender side, Prestige Capital, as well as from the borrower side, Cure Hydration and PuffCuff. You won't love what you don't know. Financial knowledge leads to financial confidence. When you have both financial knowledge and confidence, you will make the best financial decision for your business. The more knowledgeable you are about the different types of debt financing, how each type works, which one is best for your company, and understand what are the common mistakes made by borrowers, what lenders are looking for in borrowers. Only then you have the necessary financial knowledge and confidence to decide if debt financing is the right strategy for you. That's why over the next few weeks, in addition to Thursday episode, every Tuesday on a weekly basis, I want to share with you, mission-driven women entrepreneurs, how to scale your business growth using strategic debt financing. This series of strategic debt financing to grow your business will be divided into three parts, where each bonus episode is short, but it will give you the important information you need to know to feel confidence with your decision to either include or exclude debt financing from your capital funding strategy. Head on over to christinasjahil.com/her CEO journey and click subscribe on your favorite podcast app so you won't miss this episode. You're listening to Her CEO Journey, the business finance podcast for women entrepreneurs. I'm your host, Christina Sjahil. If you are new here, a big warm welcome. If we are not connected on LinkedIn, please reach out and say hi, because that's where I hang out and share my business finance tip. If you have been listening to this podcast for over a year, I want you to know I appreciate you. My podcast won't be around without your support. This is a free weekly show where my guests and I inspire you to achieve financial equality through your business. If there is something I haven't covered yet in this podcast that you are eager to learn more about, I want to hear from you. Send me a private message on LinkedIn or record your question using the link in the show notes. Simply record your name, business, and your question, and I will feature you in a bonus episode. My guest is Ceata and Garrett Lash. Ceata is the founder and inventor of the PuffCuff hair clamp, and Garrett is the CEO of PuffCuff LLC. When Ceata was named of President's Innovation Award winner by Sally Beauty, they were introduced to invoice factoring because they need to finance the large order received from Sally Beauty. In this conversation, they share why and how invoice factoring is the best financing strategy for their business. Let's find out Ceata and Garrett's CEO journey. Ceata and Garrett Lash, welcome to Her CEO Journey. You are the second couple in my podcast, and I'm always interested to see the dynamic, how you guys make it work. let's start with your journey first.
So basically, it took me a while to actually get over my fear and realize that I actually had something, a product that I could possibly bring to market. 2006, I decided to stop chemically straightening my hair. And I had been having my hair relaxed since I was 10. And I realized my body was telling me, you know what, you need to stop putting these chemicals on yourself every 4 to 6 weeks. But I wanted to be able to style it in a way that I felt comfortable in my own skin. So the way I would style my hair would be up. I would pull it all up in a puff, but I couldn't find anything that would allow me to pull it up that wouldn't cinch my hair. Because everything either couldn't accommodate the thickness and the texture of my hair, or if it could, it was like I was having to modify it in some type of way in order for it to work somewhat. But no matter what I could devise to manipulate, and like whether it was a shoestring or a headband or anything, everything always either caused me to have a headache by the end of the day or was causing me to have hair damage and breakage. And I was like, you know what, this is ridiculous that in order for me to style my hair, I got to be in pain at the end of the day. And I'm like,
yeah,
it doesn't
and
make
then work sense. And then take care of the family.
Right. And it was like, okay, I had twins, a husband. And at that time I had an hour commute both ways in Chicago traffic. So it was like, this is not going to work. So I kind of came up with there was a clip that my grandmother and my mother had used years and years ago that they still had. But it was like, that was the foundation of my idea, but I needed something on a much bigger scale because I just figured I needed something to just hold my hair in place, not cinch it down. So that's where the idea came from. But it took me 6 years to actually get over the fact of no one else had invented it.
So you were researching to find out?
Yeah, I was researching. I figured, okay, let me find, there's got to be something somewhere, whether it's overseas, and then Alibaba was still in its infancy stage, and you know, eBay was in its infancy stage, and I just couldn't find anything that would make sense in terms of matching what my concept was to something that was actually, you know, in existence. And I even used to go to Walmart and Walgreens and go down the hair accessory aisle looking for it on a regular basis, kind of hoping it was there, but at the same time, like hoping it wasn't there because I had the idea.
So you can move on with your idea.
Right, right. So fast forward to 2011. My grandmother was diagnosed with congestive heart failure, and she lived in Indianapolis. The doctor pretty much said that she couldn't live on her own anymore. And she basically was like, I'm not living with your father. So come to live with you. And we were like, okay, fine. And my grandmother came to live with us in like October, and she passed away right before January.
Then you just kind of like, you know what? I'm going to do this.
Yep. That's what I was like. I'm going to do this.
What was your first step?
I was very fortunate. I worked in higher education at a community college, and all of the adjunct professors are professionals by day. So what I did was I had a sketch, and then a friend of ours who's a carpenter, he kind of whittled a prototype for me out of wood. I just sent out like a massive amount of emails and just wanted to see if anybody would stop and, you know, talk to me about this idea that I had. And I just kept doing it until one person decided to meet me for lunch. And he was like, you really do have something here. This makes total sense. And from then on, they just connected me one to another until I found my manufacturer, my CAD drawer, and all, you know, it was just one network that I had at my disposal. Plus I used, the campus was a satellite office for the SBDC, the Small Business Development Center. So I was able to connect with them, and they helped me write my business plan, and they helped me apply for my first loan.
So you have the idea, you sketch it, and then some people saying this is going to work. And then you apply for a loan right away.
Yes, because I connected with an engineer.
Yes.
A CAD engineer.
Yes.
He was able to take my drawing and make it a 3D image. And then he was also able to print out, you know, do 3D printing and print it out some prototypes until we got it right, until we got it close to being right. And then he introduced me to my manufacturer, which is an injection molder. And he also taught injection molding at the community college. So between those two people, I was able to get a working prototype. And then they were also able to educate me on what I would need in order to bring a product to life in terms of, you know, injection molding and what all it was going to cost for me to be able to get that done.
So when you apply for the first loan, what was the plan to use it for?
The loan was for the mold. Basically, they call it a tool or tooling. So the mold was 100% for to pay for the mold.
Okay. So you haven't even have any sales at all at that point?
Oh, no.
Okay. So how difficult is it to apply for a loan when it's just an idea? And then what type of information that you have to provide to the lender?
It's difficult as all hell.
Because, I mean, really, that first loan was really banked on all of our personal...
It was banked on him because...
Right, because at the time I was full-time at Allstate.
So it was a personal, it's more like based on your personal credit history. It's not any business credit history.
No, and I ended up having to go through an organization called Axion, which they, what they do is they loan to the underserved. Their niche is to loan to minorities and women. So that's the only way I was able to do it.
Oh.
And even then it went on based on Garrett's salary and his potential to pay back the loan. Not mine.
Then what is the next step after the molding?
Once the mold was done and we reached our next hurdle for capital, the next low-hanging fruit for us was really going against my 401k as well as borrowing against our life insurance policies.
Because no one is lending money if you're not like a tech startup or... you have a relative that's going to give you, you know, that owns $1 million building that's just going to like give you,
right, allow you, you to know, use it for collateral.
This is just like, it's, you're not going to get any money. It literally was what came in. It was using our good credit, which it destroyed our credit for a while, but we were able to build it back up. But it literally was using our credit.
How long did it take you to basically from the molding from that 2000, the idea, I think you said you started February 2012 to get your first sales.
We started retailing in February 2014.
And then during that time, you are using loan, 401k, and basically your personal fund. You're basically bootstrapping.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then until when did you continue working, though, Ceata, at the college?
I continued to work up until 2015 when we moved to Atlanta. It was Bank of America that allowed us to move out of Illinois. When we moved to Atlanta, that's when I dedicated, you know, I wanted to go full-time for PuffCuff. I did work freelance for a little bit for another college, but that was the start of it. Once we got here, we were selling on Amazon, and we sold on Amazon mm-hmm. first because... Yeah. No one knew what the PuffCuff was. No one, mm-hmm. you know, and it was an accessory that had a learning curve to it, which we didn't realize because I was so close to it that I didn't realize that people were so used to using things that were not for their hair that they would use the PuffCuff wrong.
Uh-huh.
And I had to go through, you know, there was education with the product, but with launching on Amazon, it allowed us to lean on Amazon's reputation for customer service and return policy and everything for people to, you know, be willing to take a bit of a risk on trying a product that they had never heard of or a company that they had never heard of before.
Right now, when I look at your website, you have ambassador program, you have affiliate program, you even have Facebook, Instagram in Spanish, you have Facebook, Instagram in Portuguese, and you have market almost everywhere, except for Canada.
No, we do. We're in Sally Beauty, Canada.
You started retailing February 2014, right? And then your marketing is like expanded. Even through like several languages. How did you guys do it?
I'll back it up a little bit. We mm-hmm. went to a really big beauty show. It was called in New York. It's called IBS, International Beauty Show, I believe, mm-hmm. at the Jacob Javits Center. And we were there as an emerging brand. And it was the first time that we were actually at a exhibition where it wasn't primarily catered to African-American women. And it was the first time where there was no like racial bias. Mm-hmm. It was just literally everybody in the beauty industry, and everybody in the beauty industry already has more of an open mind, and they're not, you know, they're creative people. So they're not set in trying to make you fit into a box, or they don't fit into a box themselves. But what happened was we were approached by, I mean, everyone, every ethnicity. And you know, you're in New York, so you got, you know, it's the hodgepodge of everybody. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it was old, young, male, female, whatever. And everybody that came to the table was like, I get that. I need it. But then they would talk in different languages. And when I say different languages, for instance, we would have European curlies come to the table and say, I need that because of the crimp. And I'm like, I'm sorry, I don't know what that is. What is the crimp? And they were like, well, you know, when you put a rubber band around your hair and your hair might be damp by the time it dries and you take that rubber band out, you have that big crimp or that big circle around your head. And I'm like, oh, I get that. But Black women never take their hair down. After it's up, it is up till you go to bed. So it's like, basically it was like we had the same issues, but we described them in different ways. Mm-hmm. And Aaron and I realized, you know what, this is bigger than what we thought. There is so many more people that can use this mm-hmm. than just people of African descent. And there were mm-hmm. so many men that were there that had their hair is in way better shape than women because they don't, you know, they haven't mistreated it. They're not coloring it and they're not stripping it and they're not putting heat on it. So their colors yep. were like big and luscious. And they're like saying the same thing. I get a headache. I don't like to wear this because it's, you know, it's too much on my hair. And this, mm-hmm. I was like, Garrett, I think we're being too narrow in who we think our target market is. So it was just like opening it up, opening our eyes, and then also paying attention to our fans, because we've always touted ourselves as a curly hair product, not a African-American product. We just happen to be African-American owners. Mm-hmm. But it really wasn't until like a young lady from India, her name is Honest Liz, that's her handle on social media, and she has a huge curly hair following. Mm-hmm. I don't even know really how she got a puff cuff, but she ended up doing a video, and that just totally opened our market to include women and men that were not necessarily of African descent, but just has that thick, curly, textured hair.
Okay. So that is basically kind of like give you the trajectory to expand your market.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So what is next? Because I know Sally Beauty also have a role with your trajectory here.
Sally Beauty was interesting because Sally Beauty, it was bittersweet because what happened was when we ended up getting into Sally Beauty, we went into what we call the Sally Beauty effect. So people stopped purchasing from our website waiting for it to show up in Sally's stores. Oh. And they were just like waiting for it to get on Sally's shelves. And it didn't happen. Like we won the award in August and we didn't get on their shelves until November. So it was a big dip in revenue.
Okay. And but what did you guys do?
Hold on for dear life.
Hold on for dear life. I thought that after you won an award, yes, me, the normal person, thought that it's going to happen right away.
Nope. In some cases, it probably does if the planning is done properly.
Sally Beauty also didn't realize for small businesses, we only have so much capacity, especially if you're not coming along with additional funding to help these businesses, you know, move at the speed of Sally. And it was like, no, we've got to, this goes from us fulfilling online orders through Amazon and our website to 3,000 stores, you know?
Yeah, we had a moment of panic, but then we also began to do some negotiation up front.
Right.
With Sally.
Okay. And that's where Garrett came in, because he was like, wait, we got to pump the brakes and be like, this is what we can do and what we can't do.
Please elaborate, because I'm interested to hear this.
In order to make it a win-win for both Sally Beauty and PuffCuff, mm-hmm. and we knew what our capacity really was, we had to create a rollout plan. And so I went to my spreadsheet, my second love, and started creating seriously a calendar of, based on our capacity. I think it was a 4-stage plan for us to be completely rolled out domestically in 4 different deliveries. The deliveries were spaced out enough so where it wouldn't hurt so bad. And we can keep up with our manufacturing, keep up with the capacity that's needed. And our co-packer could, you know, keep up with that capacity that's needed. And fortunately enough, Sally Beauty, when we presented it to them, they were like, okay, yep, nope, that makes sense. And so that's how we rolled out domestically in 8 to 9 months. Mm-hmm. We did 4 stages, a 4-stage rollout. And then, you know, in the midst, you know, Ceata had mentioned that we had talked to other companies that had received, you know, some type of win, you know, or an ability to go into retail and what they had done. And that's when we had a friend of ours who has a product called Cut Buddy. And his name is Josh Esnard, and he's based out of North Carolina. And his product,
he went on Shark Tank.
Oh.
He experienced the Shark Tank effect.
Mm-hmm.
To where, okay, you know what, your show airs and you immediately have to be able to deal with the onslaught of
exactly.
And so, and in the conversation with him, I mean, I asked him, I said, man, how are you keeping up? He's the one that introduced me to factoring.
Let's get into that. Why do you need factoring? And what is factoring?
So factoring.
Those who don't know need, like, ears perk up, because this is the only way we survive. Literally, yep. The only way we survive.
It's getting capital based on your invoice. When he introduced me to a company out of the tri-state area in New York called Prestige Capital, and benefits of factoring, it allows you to receive upfront capital based on the invoices that you submitted to your retail partner. And you now have upfront capital to do operating, right? To make your product as much as possible based on those invoices. And the benefit about factoring, and if people are kind of like leery or scared about it, we've realized that factoring was the cheapest capital for us to get. It was cheaper than
the percentage rate was
2.7%, right? And it was, you couldn't find that anywhere with any traditional banking.
Right. And then they funded so quick. So all we had to do was, once we got the PO from Sally, and then we would fulfill it. And then literally the moment that it left our dock and was received at Sally's dock, then they would release the money. So we didn't have to wait that 60 days.
And then, that was initially, right? But then once we got, our relationship got, you know, more ingrained, the moment I submitted the invoices to our factoring partner, they would release the funds. Once they did a validation check with our counterpart at Sally Beauty, the invoice department, once they did a confirmation, then it really, the funds would be released fairly quickly.
Let's unpack that a little bit. How much is the fund that is being released? It's not 100%, is it?
No, it's 80%. So 80%. Okay. So giving an example of, you had an invoice of 100K.
So you invoice Sally Beauty, let's say 100K.
Mm-hmm.
Once you issue the invoice of that 100K and then you send it to Sally Beauty, Prestige Capital will give you 80,000.
Correct.
The only thing is they first confirm that Sally Beauty is in receipt of the goods. Once that happens, then they give us the 80.
Got it. Okay. But why a lot of people are scared with invoice factoring? Because they're saying the borrowing cost is high.
No. It wasn't for us.
No.
Okay. But how do you manage that?
I'm a firm believer that everything is negotiable.
Right.
All money comes with a price, but in the end, it's a contractual agreement, right? And so you have to be willing to ask. You have to be willing to negotiate. And also in the process, you also have to be willing to build a relationship. As you're building that relationship and you're negotiating, once you show good on what you negotiated, it becomes so much easier, right? And so I think the fear may be that some folks, I don't know, I mean, I can only speak for myself.
They're not familiar. I think invoice factoring for small businesses is not a familiar alternative financing. I guess that's one you think?
Yeah, I definitely know for sure that's one. If you're not familiar, then you're kind of scared of it, right? And you don't want to,
yes,
because you don't know what the impact would be on the back end.
Exactly. So just for the listener to understand, Prestis Capital, I interview Rachel Hurst, which is Garrett and Ceata are dealt with Rachel before, and then that's how they get the invoice factoring. It is a really, really great product. And even during the interview, Rachel did say it is high in terms of the cost of borrowing. But I think you need to do some kind of financial planning to make sure that the timing is right. Do you agree with that? What is your thought?
Yeah. You do have to do planning to make sure that the timing is right. But I would say you have to do your homework.
Mm-hmm. What is the homework?
Seriously, the homework is comparing and getting like-for-like information when it comes mm-hmm. to the cost of capital. There's a multitude of different ways of getting capital. And so right. you mm-hmm. create your own spreadsheet, list out all your possibles, list out what your principal amount is going to be, what your interest rate is going to be, what your terms for payback is going to be, and really have an educated decision about the cost, right?
Right. It's what you also have access to, because, I mean, here's the situation. You've got two people. We don't come from wealth. I mean, we've probably got the most money in all of our family and friends. So if you've got somebody that's got someone that has $200,000 or $300,000 that they can loan them, that's a relationship type of situation to where they have access to that, versus Garrett and I that do not have people that we can go to and say, I've got this business idea, I've got this invoice, and I need this much money to get this done, then yeah, it might be the cost of doing that friend transaction for them is a lot less than what, you know,
yep.
as factoring, but we had to do what was available to us. Does that make mm-hmm. sense?
Yeah, completely. It completely makes sense. Before you decided to work with Prestis Capital, did you guys consider other debt financing, getting another loan? Did you guys consider like equity financing?
Everything you could consider, we did it. We tried. We went to a bank at least once a year. We would approach a traditional bank, maybe twice a year. Approach traditional bank, mm-hmm. hand over our business plan and show that we were making money, showing that we were in the black, showing mm-hmm. what our market was, showing what our margins are, all of that. And it was like speaking a foreign language, because we literally were up against, I wouldn't say up against, but we were presenting to 60-year-old white men that don't even know that hair is an issue. They say, oh, your business plan looks great, but don't you have an uncle or somebody you can go?
Are you serious? That's the answer?
That was the answer. Don't you have any relatives that you... I'm like, well, if we did, honey, would we be here? Would we be here having this conversation? So it was to the point where it was a joke. And then the more that we started getting into networking with other small businesses that look like us, they would all say the same thing.
That's insane, because I would think... Yeah, because I would think that you guys, when the Sally Beauty Award happened, that was like August 2018. And then you've been in business for quite some time. You were able to get a loan already before that, right? So,
no, we got our $16,000 loan from the very beginning. Got an ACE loan when Garrett came on board. He was able to acquire us an ACE loan, but literally, one was for $16,000. The ACE mm-hmm. loan was for $50,000. And literally the ACE loan cleaned up a lot of mess that I had made taking like those overnight loans, those micro loans.
Oh,
I had gotten desperate through a couple of those years, because one thing, we didn't necessarily need the money. I felt like we needed the money. And then I also felt like I was some type of failure because I had not had any venture capitalist money. I had not gotten an investor, and I was thinking that I was lacking something if I wasn't getting that type of funding. So I got some microloans that in the end showed me that any fast money is bad money. It's designed to take your company away. And literally that's what it's for. So
this is a very interesting point that you brought up, because I just read an article. Okay. And then this article talked about financing available to woman business owner. Okay. Mm-hmm. And one of the way that they mention it's microloan.
Run fast and one far.
Okay. Why? Can you explain it, guys?
Because my microloans, the rate that you have to pay back is almost exponentially, it's sped up. And so in order to keep up with the payments, your revenue has to match or exceed the amount of revenue that's coming in. So the pace of revenue coming in has to exceed the pace that they're asking you to pay back.
There's micro lenders that are, they're predatory lenders. Those type of things where they're like, you're paying back on a daily, usually you're paying back on a daily cadence. And then, I mean, one of the loans was like 40 something percent. Yeah, it was terrible. Very high interest rate, but the way they sell it to make it not look so bad is they take payments on a daily basis. And then there's different micro loans. Working capital loans. We utilize working capital loans a lot, like PayPal working capital, which they take a daily payment, but it's only a percentage of what your sales are to make sure that they aren't taking more than what you're making. Where these other loans, they're taking a certain amount, period, every day, no matter what your sales are.
Wow. So how did you guys get out from the microloan?
ACE, Access to Capital for Entrepreneurs, another non-for-profit that lends to the underserved. Garrett was able to work with ACE to get us a loan, and it was for $50,000.
Yes.
And it went from, because my microloans, literally my payment was $8,000 a month.
Wow.
And by the time we got the ACE loan, which was for $50,000, and we paid off all those ridiculous microloans, my ACE loan was $1,000 a month.
Whoa. That's huge.
It's huge. It's huge, right?
So we gained back $7,000 a month by doing our own kind of our own refinance, right?
So Ceata, if Garrett didn't jump in at that moment,
I was already checking out. I mean, it was all ordained by God because literally we couldn't see the forest for the trees.
I would love to hear, what would be your advice to women entrepreneurs, the underserved, who are reluctant to consider and ask for debt financing or equity financing? What would be your best advice to them?
Everybody's road is different. Your success may not come the same way as theirs did, but that's okay. You know, you got to do it. You got to work with what you have to work with and just keep your mind open and keep your eyes open for those different opportunities. But I think that's probably my biggest thing is, you know, not comparing myself to other businesses.
Are you ready for equity financing now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm glad we did not get it before because we weren't ready.
We weren't ready.
We were not ready at all.
Why were you not ready? You think?
Because we didn't know our numbers ourselves.
We thought we knew, but yeah, we didn't know. We weren't comfortable with our numbers. We weren't, right? It's almost like an intimacy.
Right. You have to get intimate with your numbers and be like, okay, you know what? This is like, because you made these five figures this month, but how come the checking account doesn't feel that way? And we've had some really great people in our corner that we met at the end of last year that's taken us through beginning part of this year that has really helped us to understand what our numbers mean, because your numbers tell a story about your business. It can tell, the skeletons in your closet, your numbers tell your skeletons. And, you know, so once you understand before you start, you know, talking at the mouth, you need to understand what's in your closet.
It's so true. You need to get intimate with your numbers. So true. So, but I'm curious though, like just one last question for Garrett. So when you say intimate with your number, what exactly you do like on a monthly basis to make sure that you are intimate with your number?
So I've established a cadence. And so this is the part of the corporate piece that I didn't let go. Right. And then I brought along. I established a monthly cadence with my CPA, my bookkeeper, and our financial manager. And that monthly cadence, we go through our numbers. We go through our expenses, our revenue, our net income, our cash flow, and we talk about our expenses from our budget perspective of whether or not, you know, we were under budget or we hit exactly what we were projecting to do that month. And we get granular in our numbers. And so, and that granular conversation allows me to be comfortable with what's happening and what's going on. Because like Ceata said, the numbers tell you your story. The numbers tell you your behavior. And they tell you how the life of your business.
If you can sustain at what you're doing, or do you got to change?
Yep.
Did that help you during this pandemic?
Oh, yeah.
Make you able to react quicker?
For instance, we just started bundling products. We needed to be able to tell the customer a story. And within that story, they identify with all the stuff that they need to do their hair for that specific situation. And then we sell them everything they need in one bundle instead of them, you know, picking out a la carte products. It helped us pivot through this because we've been having supply chain issues. Now we can't keep the stuff in stock.
Please let my audience know, where can they find you both, and then what is your website?
You can find us. Our website is www.thepuffcuff.com. Mm-hmm. And on social media, our handle is @thepuffcuff.
Everywhere. It's the same thing everywhere. We are on Amazon.com, and then we are in all Sally Beauty stores domestically and Canada, and we're on SallyBeauty.com.
Ceata and Garrett Lash, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. We really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for joining me here every week at Her CEO Journey, the business finance podcast for women's entrepreneurs. Head on over to ChristinaSjahil.com/Her CEO Journey to subscribe for this podcast. And don't forget to tell other women entrepreneurs that this podcast is available for free in the podcast apps of their choice. Until next time, and let's continue to grow a business that fuels the life that you want to live.